folks are arriving, I will go over the necessary, unfun, but necessary welcoming type of information. My name is Aysha Upchurch, and I am the founder and director of HipHopEX, which is a project, an initiative, a lab that is run out of the Harvard Graduate School of Education, where we are centering hip hop so that we can explore, we can experiment, we can experience the power of hip hop culture and education in a variety of settings. We're not just talking about brick and mortar schools, we're talking about the real world. So that's who we are, HipHopEX. We are in our third year. Our first year, we met every other week, high schoolers and graduate students, to be centering hip hop and crossing that generational divide to do community programming. Second year, we launched an elective at a high school. This year, we are hitting these virtual streets to bring you monthly programming on a variety of topics and themes that are pertinent to the world. And of course, hip hop is very important to the world. So we're gonna talk about that. This is our traditional launch month. So we are kicking off our yearly programming with this week-long series dedicated to us looking at the schools of hip hop, old school to new school, to where we are and where we may be headed. And we don't even know what we might mean by the schools of hip hop. So today's conversation is going to be very intentional and asking us to name what's old school, what do you consider new school? What era is this? Like, what y'all thinking? So we're gonna have some amazing guests with us today to get into it. We also wanna let you all know, if you are not able to join us in the Zoom room, we are also streaming onto our Facebook channel. So for any folks who are on, are gonna drop that link, because that's what we do these days. We are constantly dropping links in the chat box. I feel like that could be the name of an album, right? Drop it in the chat. Just drop it in the chat. Okay, Aysha, and focus. Focus, be professional. anyway, so please feel free to engage with our guests in the chat. Let us know who you are. You can talk to us on Facebook. You can talk to us here in Zoom. Let us know who you are, where you're joining us from. This is a webinar format, so our guests can't see your faces, but they can see your energy. So make sure you stay engaged. When we have comes to our time for questions and answers, we will give folks the opportunity to unmute your mic and your video if you want to pose your question live, or as live as we can be in this Zoom space. So again, I'm Aysha. I'm excited to get things kicked off, and I'm excited to introduce the co-moderator slash DJ for this session, one of 2021's Lab Fellows, Remy Fernandez O'Brien, How you feeling today?
I'm feeling really good. I'm excited for this conversation that we're about to have, because I do not know what school of hip-hop we are in.
What school of hip-hop did you meet? Do you think you met hip-hop in its old school times or in its new school times?
I mean, I really met hip-hop in like 2007, so that's got to be new, right? That's like post-snap dance era. Right, but we Laffy Taffy.
No.
How about you?
Oh, well, see, now, you know, that's almost like asking me how old I am, which I'm proud of my age. I feel like I can say that it was definitely old school. I am an 80s baby. Shout out to any 80s babies. We have any 80s babies with us today, right? 70s, 80s, if y'all in the building, let us know. So I met hip hop when I was a little thing. I'm the youngest of four, so whatever my siblings were doing, I was doing, so I was trying to wop it, and my neck got stuck. So I met hip hop through dancing as a little one, like, you know, so that feels like it was an older time, but I'm also here learning about the new stuff. So, you know, whoop, whoop, 70s in the building. Let us know what school of hip hop are y'all rocking with? When did you get on the train? because we are going to get a chance to talk with our guests about this. So without any further ado, should we go ahead and introduce the folks, Remy?
I'll introduce the first guest.
Okay.
This man right here, Brian Polite, met him at 36 Chambers a few years ago in New York City. 36 Chambers, for folks who don't know, is it's like the mecca of hip hop dance. It's where Buddha Stretch and Khalif Sellers and Ejo all get together. And I started asking people questions and then said, oh, you gotta talk to our resident scholar over here. And they led me over to Brian Polite, who is just has been so incredibly generous with his wisdom and his time. I'm really excited that he will be here today. So introduced to New York City's house community while attending Grant Institute, Brian Polite has facilitated dance workshops, therefore college lecture demonstrations on house students. He has been a panelist at the 2018 Dance New York City Symposium and 2013 EMP Conference at NYU. Brian is currently a member of Ase Dance Theatre Collective, co-founder of Afro Mosaic Soul Dance Collective, co-founder of the street dance think tank, Kut The Rug Institute. Please give it up for Brian Polite.
Tomorrow may never show up. For you and me, this life is not a promise. I see no purpose.
How you doing, Brian?
I'm doing really well.
And what school of hip-hop did you get on the train with? What school of hip-hop did you get on the train with?
The tail end of the old school. I was born in the late 70s, born in 77. So, you know, a couple years after hip hop was invented, a few years right before the rest of the world outside of New York knew it existed. I remember when people were questioning whether or not any part of hip hop was valid artistic expressions. You know, watching amazement at this thing that, you know, was on big, so old school.
All right. Good to have you here, Brian.
Indeed, it's great to be here.
Aysha, you want to take this next one or should I?
I got it, because I'm a little like bit of a fangirl. So also, you know, we up here celebrating hip hop, right? And we know hip hop is a genius. It is genius. And we're continuing to push the boundaries of what technology that wasn't thinking about us is made to do. So even though Zoom might sometimes not let us be great with our sounds coming and our vocals coming, we're gonna figure it out. So let's do this like this, Remy, because we wanna make sure we hear the groove and we hear the voices. So I'm gonna introduce this person. I'm gonna read their whole bio and then you can play the music and let them appear. So yeah. I'm excited to introduce our next guest. She is a dope artist. I will say as a non-Boston native, someone who's come to the area, she was one of the first musicians I heard that I was like, yo, okay. So Oompa is with us. Oompa is a nationally acclaimed Boston born poet, rapper, and educator who is forever representing the queer, Black, orphaned hood kids in them. She was named one of NPR's 2020 Slingshot Artists to Watch, and her engaging, interactive performing style won her the Boston Music Award for Live Act of the Year in 2019. In 2018, her unsigned Artist of the Year victory among an unprecedented 12 total nominations. In a 2019 feature, WBUR's The Artery describes the lyric-focused rapper as having a natural tenderness with language and calls her verses funny, inclusive, and memorable. Give it up for Oompa! Let's go!
The whole bio, huh?
In the game, just my pain on display. With no games, I'ma play high. Balls are cheaper than therapy. Let that sink into your noggin. The Tondre is everything. Gotta thank my mama Laura and Donna for everything. Christmases and bail money and all of their modesty. Don't know where I'd be without them. I just know about where I was.
The whole bio, huh?
It's fire. It's fire.
Thank you so much for having me.
In case anybody could have possibly missed that, that was Oompa rapping right there, right on that track.
So Oompa, same question to you to just get into it. When you think about old school, new school, what school of hip hop is where you got on this train, where you got on this journey? When did you meet hip hop?
You know, It's funny that the song that you played first, by one of my favorites right now, Middle Child. I'm a middle child in real life. I'm a middle child in a lot of different ways. And I think that my old school is the new school to some people. And then the first record I ever heard that was a hip hop record, because my mother used to just listen to soul, funk, you know, that kind of stuff. It was Arrested Development, People Every Day. So that was my first record. And I was like, what are they doing? And, you know, I kept going on. And then, you know, I was growing up in the 90s. And so that's where I caught on.
I love it. Oh.
Yay.
Yes, I love it. I love how both of you all, like, your answers just already set the scene that when we even try to get into discussions, and some people might call debates, about new school and old school, there is a bit of relativity to it. So thank you all for letting us know where you got on. We're hoping folks can also just think about, well, when, how, what was your entry point? Mm-hmm. Is that old for you? And like, we definitely don't want to call nobody old, right? Like, I'm just putting that out there into the ether. You was gonna say something, Brian?
I got too many gray hairs to act like I'm not old. Like, it's just kind of what it is. Like,
you're seasoned. Or as me and my friends say, that's called Lowry's.
I like to call it vintage. Vintage. Vintage.
I heard it. Vintage Lowry's.
Vintage Lowry's. Here come the trouble zone. On my radio tape, play a box right. Box just right. Loud enough so folks can hear us. Hype scene. And that's why I still feel like there's hope for me to be at least in a group, because I can be a hype person. I was made for that. So we're about to get into it. Remy and I throughout this evening are going to bounce a couple of questions to both of our amazing guests, and then we're going to have time to hear from folks who are with us on Facebook or who are here with us on Zoom in the chat. So Remy, I'm going to bounce past to you to see like how you want to get this. How shall we engage?
Yeah, I'd love to start both of y'all off with a question of,
for the rest of the world outside of New York knew it existed. I remember what people were questioning.
I'm hearing somebody's audio. Sorry. Okay. I'd love to know how you're thinking about, if you can give like a little chronology in your head, as loose as it might be, like when did old school end? Is there a middle school? When did new school begin? Are we post right now? If you can just maybe take a first stab at answering that question. What's our chronology?
Ooh. All right. I'll basically take the shots, and you know, just Oompa, while I'm down, while they're distracted, just go for the goal line.
That's it. That's it. So, unless we're going in opposite directions and then it's, yeah. And we're confused.
So for me, I think the old school era is from Kool Herc, like from the very beginning. And I think it ends really in 1987. I think like, and the reason why I say 87 is because what happens in 88 is that you have Public Enemy, Big Daddy Kane, Heavy D, KRS-One, and like all those MCs where their first albums were kind of like 86, 87, but then when they all dropped albums in 88, their styles were radically different. You know, it's like old school KRS-One was rapping in a very like traditional at that time, old school, you know, 80s, and then 88, all of a sudden, compound syllables, faster phrasing, more imagery, more complicated rhyme flows, different types of beats being made, you know, the sampler being cheap enough where people could then start chopping up a lot of the old school breaks and experimenting with various ways of using those. So I feel like that, like 88 kind of begins like the new school, what people sometimes like to call the golden era. And I feel like that era really only lasts until 93, maybe 92. Like it's a short blip of the era because all the creativity that comes out of that in terms of all the different types of hip hop that exist during the era. And then 93, everything starts going corporate and you don't see the full effect of that until like 97 or so. But like 93 kind of changes everything with the whole so-called East versus West and the so-called gangster rap thing. Like that represents a change because you have those two dynamics. You have smaller hip hop labels being bought out by major labels starting in the like mid 90s. And that changes the nature of the music. And I feel like that, the high point of that is like 97, 98, you know, where almost every other song was either Bad Boy or So So Def. And I feel like that era kind of lasts until the early 2000s. And then after that, you know, once you hit the early 2000s, the South rises to prominence and kind of dominates the sonic scape after that. And then following that, you could say like now we're in the era of the internet where all bets are off. You know, you can't really pick the winners like how they used to in the traditional music industry. You know, it's more like you have to kind of catch the wave that's coming up and then see if you can ride it out. So, you know, people get famous having three songs on SoundCloud. And then some of them go on to become superstars, you know, for a couple of years. And other ones, they had that one hit. And then next season, we're like, oh, you remember that guy? So, I mean, that loosely, that's kind of the chronology, at least in my head, sort of.
That was impressive. Thank you. I don't know what I was expecting.
Years trying to figure this out.
What do you think, Oompa?
I mean, I think I'm playing around with two different philosophies in answering these questions today. And one is kind of like in the same, I'm in the same world as you, Brian, thinking about the chronology of hip hop. And then the other part of it is thinking about the spiritual nature of hip hop being cyclical. Mm-hmm. And always now and always reminiscent of the past and like always futurist and always like, you know, but it's always all there. And so I want to, you know, I'm making space for the way I'm thinking about it, you know, in that regard. But yeah, I can't say more than Brian already said, because he's got the chronology down. So yeah,
that's dope though. I hadn't even, like, in terms of thinking about it in terms of like a spiritual and cyclical nature, that's making me like reevaluate like a whole separate level of even like interpreting it.
Yeah, I don't know. I've been thinking about that a lot. Even, you know, some of the music that a lot of my peers or a lot of people who are, you know, slightly older or appreciate generations of music that come right before this one, kind of look at, you know, today's really simplistic or really overt, you know, language, or like even the simplicity of some of the music. And I'm like, and I'm remembering, you know, the music that my uncles put me onto and how similar they are, or how, you know, one minute, you know, the push for civil rights through music is the goal. And the next minute, you know, making money and surviving is like, and I think that the spirit of Black people is just a cyclical one, and same with hip hop, I think.
I totally feel
like it's on fire trying to like write down all of these nuggets. No, seriously.
Nuggets.
Y'all, I hope people hungry, because they are dropping nuggets, y'all. They are dropping nuggets, or nuggets of gold and nuggets of wisdom.
I'm just glad we're recording this.
I know. Yeah, like I'm fascinated with the timeline, the chronology that you offered, Brian, and because in that I could go like, where was I in 87? Like, I think when we hear timelines, we immediately go like, where was I? we think about those big dates. Oh yeah, well, where were you when Pac was killed? Where were you when Biggie was murdered? Where were you when Andre, when Outkast said, like, you know, the South, it was, you know, weird. So it's, I appreciate that, because I think that's one of the things about hip hop is it keeps going. It's not finished, right? And so everybody's going to be able to identify with that timeline. And then Oompa, I love, like, immediately my brain just started seeing and making circles and being like, yeah, because also in hip hop, we sample. We take with what's there, create something, put it out. So there's always looping, and yet the looping is moving because time makes us move this way. So I'm just trying to catch up with what the way you all are putting it. And I want to maybe take a step back to then to go, well, what was it? And I know Brian, you're a dancer. Not, you're not just a dancer, you're many things. So Oompa, you're not just a musician. You all are multidimensional humans. So let's keep it straight. Don't try to put them in a box. Yet I'm wondering where you got on this train, this wave in hip hop, and where it was in that chronology. Like, what spoke to you at the moment where you met hip hop? And, cause you know, I like a compound question. So what spoke to you when you met hip hop, and does that thing, is it still there for you now?
Oh, so hip hop for me is like the playground crush that, you know, we had a very long, knew each other our whole lives, grew up together, and then went away to college, and then we kind of grew apart, and we still check on each other and catch up occasionally, but we aren't close like how we used to be. That's sort of my relationship with hip hop. So for me, hip hop was kind of, I can't even pinpoint the first moment. I just remember I was always into music because my mom was always playing music in the house. And the radio was always on, and I loved watching people dance. So I was always watching Soul Train. That was just part of growing up in my house. There was always, you know, I was a little kid when the Motown 25 hit, when breakdancing became a phenomenon and everybody had a news story about kids spinning on their heads in New York. I grew up in New Jersey, you know, but like, so I was watching all that stuff and just, you know, me and my little friends would be out in front of the sidewalk in front of my house, you know, with dish rags tied around our heads, thinking they were bandanas, trying to backspin, you know, on a piece of cardboard, you know, with a little like tape recorder, acting like it was a boombox, you know. So it was just for me with hip hop, it was this new thing, and we just tried everything. So I tried to do bubble letter graffiti, realized that I wasn't that good at it. I almost ruined the needles on my mom's record player trying to scratch. I realized that was a bad idea. I didn't really start writing until later, so, you know, MCing for me wasn't anything I thought I was going to do. I kind of fell into that more in my teen years, but dancing was something that immediately caught on with me. And so, you know, between early BET and the early rap videos and Soul Train, dance was like the major driving force. And then I would kind of sample the other elements as I got older.
Dope. And I think for me, you, trying to think about my analogy that you just used at the beginning, I think mine is like, it was so much a part of everything. Like, for you, name, like, I, this is an interesting experience, it seems, of it being a new thing. And it's like, we're cultivating that in real time as an active choice. And I think when I was growing up, the choice was already made that this was a part of what it meant to be exactly who I was at the time and location that I was. And so for me, I think hip hop has been like my best friend, and I thought we were the exact same person. And you know, I wanted this best friend to be exactly what I thought they were, and a reflection of me and what I learned I was. And then I learned that, you know, this friend of mine is multifaceted in the way that I am. And I just allowed this friend to breathe and become whoever it is that they are, and accept them for who they are instead of like trying to like have this codependent relationship. So I think that's my relationship. I listened to my first, like I said, record. It was Arrested Development, because all the stuff in my house was like Bob Marley, Aretha Franklin, Frankie Lyman, like stuff like that. My mother was born in the 30s. I was adopted. So I got the benefit of like being able to grow up on James Brown and Funkadelic and stuff like that. And so I'm used to all the melody, all the instruments. And then when I heard this thing, I was like, oh, I like that. And it wasn't the kind of thing that wasn't like an active, this is hip hop and it exists. I just knew it was different. And then I had these play cousins who would come over after school every day, and they would go to the living room where the TV was, and they would watch BET the whole time that they were at my house. So I kind of just started watching on the periphery, like, this is cool. This is what the cool kids are doing, and really enjoying it. And I just remember by the time I was in middle school and battle rap had come up, I think Cassidy was like the guy at this time. And I think we just started back. I was writing all, because I was like, if I'm gonna rap, then I have to be a girl rapper, right? So I would write Left Eye and Eve and MC Light, and I would write all of their lyrics down and change the words so I could learn how to rap. And then by the time I got to middle school and I was trying to do it out loud in this battle rap fashion, we were just at the tables, banging on the tables in the cafeteria, getting in trouble and freestyling. And I think, you know, the rest is kind of history. It's always been like this thing that I wanted to do and be a part of. But I didn't always know what my access point was outside of the cultural one, you know? So I became a poet and then eventually started rapping again. And now it's what I do full time. So,
right.
Yeah.
Let's shout out the importance of having the banging on the lunchroom classroom tables experience, right? As you were saying earlier, Oompa, like, listen, y'all, I'm really like trying to keep up the spirit of Black folks, the spiritual and cyclical, just also thinking about what is inherently embedded in hip hop because of its manifestation of Africanist traditions and cultural practices is like, we need a beat. We need a drum. We gonna make one, either or beat machine or the table. And I just like hearing your story, and also like both of you all's metaphors, like the playground crush and the best friend. And I want to be like, well, you know, sometimes, you know, your crush always will do a little something something for you. So I'm like, you know, does the crush still do that thing for you? Does the crush still do the thing for you, Brian?
You know, right now, I'm in a very serious relationship with house music.
Okay.
But, you know, there's times where, like I said, there's times where I do, you know, catch up with hip hop and be thinking like, you know, maybe we could have made it work. And then something happened, be like, nah, we're cool.
But y'all cool.
Yeah.
You don't like run the other way when you see them coming down the street.
No. Like we could chop it up and reminisce and, you know, and talk about the good old days, but I think we've grown apart in some ways where the relationship is definitely not the same anymore. At least not for me.
And Oompa, do you still feel like there's that best friend? Like my best friend knows that if I don't talk for 3 months, it's not that we broke up. I be off in Aysha land, and then we hook up and we understand we still best friends, but we don't be like, let's dress alike. So do you still have that best friend?
I'm an Aquarius, so that's how my friendships go.
Okay.
Period. Yeah. I think that it's like even evolving from the idea of a best friend, it's like, you my friend, like I love you like family, we here. But I might be chilling with R&B one day, and I might be chilling with house one day, and I might be chilling with, you know, whatever, like jazz the other day, and we're all still good. And you know, you still my sis, so you still my bro, you know, we still love each other like that. So we gonna always love each other like that. And it's a good time when we link up.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're getting an Aquarius testimony.
Shout out to the air signs.
One thing I'm wondering about is, so far it seems like, and I think this happens in general. So far, we've been defining schools according to music and like how rap has changed specifically. And I'm curious, in terms of the evolution of dance, or even in terms of the evolution of graffiti, DJing, do you think that the shifts in rap, do they mirror larger shifts in hip hop culture? Do they mirror, are there certain turning points and moments that are also shifts in not just rap or not just in the wider culture, but also in the dance world?
In terms of dance, the causes, a lot of the causes are the same, but they play out different. So, you know, for the dance, you know, there's the, from the beginning, there's the B-boy era. And that's like the primary, you know, hip hop with people looking at like, oh, this is hip hop dance. And they're focused entirely on, you know, breakers. And then after that, then you have, some people say new school style, some people will say hip hop freestyle. But you have essentially what, you know, folks like Mob Tops, like that it's like, you know, that more freeform hip hop style. So you see it in Mob Tops, you see it in the Soul Brothers, you see it in the Misfits. You know, a lot of dances, that New Jack Swing era dances, where it's like, it's hip hop, it's a little house, it's a little, you know, but it's more loose, but then it's still based in the earlier styles. And that kind of coincides with, you know, hip hop videos becoming a big thing. And then you see, as it becomes mainstream, then you have more mainstream sort of dancers. And then and that kind of pulls in the whole like street jazz thing. And that evolution where like now people say hip hop dance class, and you're like, okay, am I getting, what sort of hip hop dance? Am I getting old school slash classic hip hop, you know, like the Running Man or, you know, the RoboCop, or am I getting street jazz, in which like they're saying hip hop, and what that really means is, you know, pirouettes and baggy jeans.
Aisha's doing it for us right now.
Right. So, you know, so it's, in, I mean, and then, the other thing that, because I know this part of this is about the whole post-hip hop thing, and then there's also all the styles that have branched from hip hop. You know, so you look at, you know, Crump, you look at Flex and Brookup, you look at Lightfeet, you could say Turf, you could say, you know, stuff coming out of Memphis, and they have elements of hip hop dances that we recognize in them, but the communities are more separated from the mainline hip hop narrative. So like, you know, so they're related to hip hop, but they've gone back underground, or they've just managed to stay underground for whatever reason. And so you very rarely will see them promoted in a video or in someone's commercial very often. It might be like a one-off, but they're not like, you know, scores of people. Like, it's not like in 88 or whatever, where Big Daddy Kane is looking for extra dancers beyond his two. He could go to a club, you, you got some peoples? Yo, I'm doing a video next week. Give me your numbers. I need you guys to come down. Whereas now it's like there's an audition process and agents and everything else. And that skews towards a different demographic of people, a different skill set of movers. And it tends to exclude a lot of folks that come from the streets when it comes to street dance. So that, you know, in terms of those eras, like that, you know, there's kind of like a pre-corporate and a post-corporate era.
Yeah, wow.
I can't really speak to graffiti. I know cats that are writers, but I can't really say left or right about that.
And I can't say much to either. Thank you, Brian, for that. Crash course of sorts.
Yeah, definitely. You said pre-corporate, post-corporate, mainstream, going back underground. Sometimes I like to just remember that folks are getting a crash course, because we very much are in a real society where we can hear words and participate in using them without actually practicing understanding them. And so I wondered, and I know Remy, you have another question, but I wondered if we could like do a backup really quickly and ask both of you, coming from the lanes and your crafts where you come from, what are we talking about when we say hip hop? Because we start going post hip hop and then it branched off, or something went underground and stayed underground, but everybody sees, you know, if you see, if you don't know, when you see Memphis Jukin, you see Crump, you see Top Rock, and you take a street jazz class and you're like, well, that's all hip hop. Or you see like somebody singing and rapping, or somebody rocking out and rapping, or never rapping, but looking hip hop, and that's hip hop. Like, I'm wondering from both of you all's lane, like, what's the definition that you all are coming to this with? If you could share that, knowing that there might be some definite variances. So I'm just wondering if y'all could share your definitions of hip hop.
I can try. I think my definition today may change tomorrow, but or even in the next 10 minutes after hearing Brian talk. But I think for me, what hip hop is more like what it aims to do, maybe, or what it is trying to always remember to me, the spirit of Blackness and the influence of Blackness. And I think that people will then say something like, well, what about white people who exist in hip hop? And I say that can still be true, is that it's about, to me, it's about the modern Black experience or the modern Black spirit and all the ways that we aim to capture that. And I think that for me, you know, whether mainstream isn't, because I have mainstream aspirations as well. So it's like, whether mainstream is involved, whether underground is involved, I think that what it is, what it tries to be is maybe a snapshot of who we are and all of our vastness. I think that, you know, hip hop rap is not just for, it's not just for the streets, you know, it's not just the lyricist. It's not just the, you know, your hood intellects. Like it's not just for any one kind of Black person. I think we exist outside of a vacuum, and so does hip hop. And so I think it's just the expansiveness of us. That's the best I can do right now. Yeah.
Damn good. I guess in my mind, I'm trying to create a space to accept, because there's always been this war with like cats that are a little bit older than myself, where at one hand, they see the influences of the things that they were at the ground level of creating in what's happening right now. And so they want everybody to say like, nah, but that's just Kumo D, except they just did this. Oh, that's just, okay, fine. So then it's hip hop. But then also they'll turn around and say, oh, but that ain't really hip hop because they're not doing this thing that we did. And it's like, okay, so pick one. And also hip hop can be forever, but it doesn't mean that it can't be supplanted or evolved from or branched off from. And so I'm still kind of like exploring the idea and trying to like encapsulate it in my mind about, is there such a thing as a post hip hop and how it functions. And you know, I think part of it was, so like in my late teens, early 20s, I was in a spoken word hip hop group called Second to Last. We were, you know, like contemporaries of Jessica Caremora, Saul Williams. Like we were in the open mics with them, kicking it all throughout Brooklyn and New York. Everybody in that scene at the time, there was this sort of feeling that what we were doing, because we were blending elements of hip hop and R&B and spoken word, there was this idea that we were working on the next genre after hip hop, that there was gonna be like this next step. Okay, hip hop's been around for X amount of time. You know, there's time for another evolution of something else. The same way that, you know, soul music was around for a certain amount of time, and then hip hop branched off from it and became its own approach without necessarily negating soul music's existence, but just kind of saying like, now there's another lane, you know, creating its own lane. On some level, we've kind of seen that. You could say that like Lauryn Hill and Wyclef, really Fugees in general, but Lauryn Hill and Wyclef, where they're singing as much as they're rapping. And then everybody afterwards kind of wanting to do the same thing. The aesthetic may not be the one that everybody thinks of, but like what is Drake doing that Lauren didn't from a mechanic standpoint? He's singing on certain records, he's rapping on other ones. Sometimes he's doing double duty and switching back and forth. And the thing is, everyone's kind of doing that, and auto-tune is allowed for that. Where now you can kind of do both. You know, people need raps with melodies now. This tends to be a thing that folks expect. So does that mean that this is still hip hop as we understood it or as understand it? Or does it mean that this is a branch of a new thing, in which case it needs to be nurtured? And it's the same thing with the dancers. Like, you know, there's a thing where most of us that grew up in the beginning of hip hop were raised on soul and jazz. So our freestyles are based in those type of phrasings. They're based in jazz phrasings because we were still hearing jazz on the radio. A lot of R&B artists still had jazz musicians playing the solos, the instrumental solos of all their records. So we grew up hearing that language, and so we're familiar with it. But for dancers coming after us, the music changed where there weren't any more instrumental solos. Now everything was made primarily in the box. You know, everything is loops. There aren't, you know, beyond maybe a bridge, there's not too much happening musically where it shifts from one thing to the other. So then everything is a series of loops. And the way that the younger dancers hear the music is different a lot of times than the way that older heads do. The relationship is the same, but the understanding is different. And so I'm still trying to parse, does that mean that it's a whole new generation of a thing, or just simply like the next step of a thing? Like, this is me questioning myself constantly.
Yeah, and for me too, I think because I can't see outside of the world in which this thing happened and it's transitioned out of something else, for me, I like can't divorce everything that comes after it from hip hop. You know, I can't see a world in which, you know, because people are like, that's not hip hop. And maybe it's also because I'm in a generational space where people are judging what is and isn't hip hop. In the era that I'm in, saying that the things that are happening right around me are or aren't hip hop. And maybe my defensiveness would say that it's all hip hop. I think we have to let it define itself for itself and for the people who need it. But then now I'm thinking about your point of, you know, if I step outside of my own lens, can I make an argument for myself that like what's happening is something right after hip hop? And yeah, I guess I'm in the same place as you with that.
Yeah, I think everybody is. That's the reason why everybody gets so worked up around it. This is why folks will, you know, try to embrace one thing and then reject the other. I mean, before this whole thing started, they were playing 1985, you know, and ironic, 1985, like considered like the apex of like old school hip hop, right? Who Run DMC. It's a song called 1985 that's done with this straight up, you know, modern trap flow, mm-hmm. You know, like doesn't sound retro at all. Like,
yeah. It's
like of the time, like right now, but it's called 1985. Like just that juxtaposition,
yeah,
kind of speaks to the confusion that everybody's kind of dealing with in terms of where we put our definitions.
Yeah.
Maybe that our heart is still in the same place that it was in 1985. Like, but that the style is just, the styles have grown. There are multiple styles.
Yeah. I think too, sorry, and then I'm gonna get out of here. I think that, you know, this is making me think about all the things that came, all the genres that came before. And like, I think it's just, maybe it's just about how we need something to hold us at the time. Mm. And I think if we look at it maybe as what, how we need to be held, we're less inclined to think about what it is or isn't, but more inclined to think about what those people need at this time, you know, versus what we needed. And like, I think maybe we become more supportive with that transition and are less inclined to think about the naming, but instead about providing the need, maybe.
Word.
I think that's
exactly right.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what drives, like all the dance cultures, that's what drives a lot of the dancers. You know, like from my standpoint, I look at it like every street dance form even beforehand, but especially like with the way that a lot of stuff from like locking on through to, you know, to light feet now, mm-hmm. how they all evolved, it's that they form a function.
Mm-hmm. You
know? So the relationship with the movement and the relationship with the music, it functions. You know, there's a reason why Vogue is what it is. It yeah. functions within that community in a certain way. There's a reason why househeads will be at the club until 6 a.m. It functions certain things. There's a reason why B-boys need to push themselves to be better than who they were, or they need to battle. Like, yeah. They need that, you know, for whatever reason, they need that in their soul. And I think it's why some people gravitate to certain styles over others. Is like you said, like it's exactly as you said, because it's how it holds them. I think that's a brilliant way of looking at it.
Mm.
I may have to send you a licensing contract because I may want to use that.
I know, like it's legit. I'm like, I wrote it down. I cite people, you know. Because like, you know, at Academy, if you don't cite your sources, you get expelled for plagiarism. But we have that already in Africanist traditions, in hip hop, like you get called out if you biting.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't give your sample its due, you can't release the music without some
playback. True.
So I got from both of y'all like a lot of gems. I hope people are catching it. I hope Remy dropping some, yeah. Yo, what's hope? What are you? I feel like when people had that strange conversation, right? Like, sorry, LeBron James or Michael Jordan, who's the GOAT? It's like, well, where did you get on at? Like, I'm always gonna love MJ, but I'm not acknowledging that it's the same sport. And that there are things that LeBron is doing and can do, rightfully so, because of evolution and because of other things that he's blessed to do. But it's like, I like them both. I'm not gonna say that's not basketball.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I like how both of y'all are saying, like, hip hop can be a thing very immediately for somebody, but it exists within this constant cyclical evolving, redefining thing. So anyway, catch them gems, y'all.
For me, that's a perfect segue into a question I had that takes it back to what you said, Oompa, about the cyclical nature of this and how there's always going to be the older thing and the newer thing, whether we're talking on the macro scale over 40 years or we're talking about like two different dance styles in one city. This came up at our Monday session because we had we were talking Boston dance scene and we had hip hoppers and crumpers together, and I would love to hear your perspective on this as well, which is like in passing the torch, in moving from one thing to the next thing, in communities relating to each other, the older one and the newer one, what are the best ways to do that? What are the best ways you've seen communities relate to each other and say like here, this is yours now, or like, oh, we're working off of what y'all did?
That's open for either one of us?
Yes.
I guess, all right. So part of it for me, because I came in as like the young head into the dance scene, and now I'm starting to become like the old man. One of the things that I've seen that's been the most successful is you got to let the young kids know that, first of all, you have to respect where they are, even if you don't understand it. Even if there might be parts of it that you don't particularly care for, you have to at least respect their stance, because they have no real reason to like give a damn what any old person, like, you know, when we were doing the Running Man, we didn't need no old person's approval. You know, like we didn't wait for them to be like, oh, I like that dance you're doing, boy. Like that there wasn't a thing for us. We did it because this was a thing that we were doing. And the older heads that supported us, or at least just gave us space to be ourselves, were the ones that when they pull us to the side later and be like, hey, well, you know, that actually comes from Bill Bailey back in such and such. Or if you ever watch tap dancers, you'll see where Hammer gets the rest of his moves from. Like, you know, it's the thing where, and it feels different because we talk about like Africanist aesthetics, like traditional culture, it would be that the elder takes supremacy. So if you're young in the game, you got to wait for the elder to recognize you to get anything. And, you know, maybe it's just the nature of being in America. It's a youth-oriented culture. So it's inverted. So it's more that as an elder, you have to wait for the youth to be ready for whatever it is you want to share. And a lot of times you have to do that on their terms. I mean, you could try to beat them in the head, but then they'll run screaming from it and they'll just feel justified and like, nah, we're not messing with them old people. Nah, they just mad salty because we got careers and, you know, I just got this museum gig and, you know, they just mad because, you know, they just was a local legend. Because that happens. You know, there's guys that were like, you know, B-boys before there was any infrastructure to make any real money from it. So they were neighborhood, you know, borough-wide, city-wide heroes. Everybody in the five boroughs back in 1974, oh yeah, you know, such and such, oh, they're dope. But there was nothing that could be done with that. 10 years later, Cass in the Olympics, you know, doing the opening ceremony. You know, so it's like, you know, so so it's more of like, if you want to share those connections, it forces those of us who are older to be a lot more humble than we feel like we're supposed to be, because we feel like we've earned our stripes. So we should have a certain amount of, like, you know, space made for us. But, you know, you see it all the time. People get large and go viral and become famous off of grabbing movement, grabbing music, you know, not citing where their sources are. And by the time somebody says, hey, wait, you got that from some little girl in Atlanta, like, they've already gotten their million something views. You know, they already cashed in with their sponsors. So, you know, okay, fine. Yeah, I got it from her, but I've made my money. So it's whatever.
That is so true. I like I said, my mother was born in 1930. So how I was raised was like, pay your dues, pay your respects first, elder centric, you know, and she was from the South. So like, you know, your elders are everything. And so for me, I'm like, I understand. I think that that approach is the one, and it is the successful one. I wish it were more like, I'm going to my fountain of knowledge to like figure out how to do this thing and stay true in this thing. I wish we had more ability culturally altogether to just point back to our OGs and pay our respects and ask for forgiveness and ask for permission and ask for wisdom and understanding. I missed that, or maybe I romanticized it and never saw it. I don't know, but I think that some personal examples I have of this passing of the torch. I'm only 4 years old in music, technically, as an out artist. So I guess I don't have that much of a life experience to pass on, except I think the people who passed me blessings were people like Acrobatic, Mark Merrin, who is a rapper, but he also makes a lot of space for people. He gave me my first stage as a hip hop artist. I was coming out of poetry, trying to get into rap, and he just believed in it and just gave me a blessing and gave me the blessing of his platform. And Dart Adams embraced me almost immediately as well, and has been like a great resource for me to like figure out, you know, what came before me and where I am and what I look to do in the future. And so I don't know. I know you were saying, like, what are some examples of that? I mean, I think I only have like really, really personal ones like that. Yeah.
Thank you. I mean, somebody was just saying in the chat, like, they appreciate your personal and testimonial perspective. And I think that's the thing, like there's something universal and then also something very personal and specific about the relationship that we have. We can say hip hop for today, or we can name other kind of cultural practices. But because this one, it's intriguing to hear how you cited this kind of inverted youth culture in the US, and that like, but then also depending how you grew up more directly in the U.S. because I'm very much from that. Y'all gonna be sitting here. We ain't gonna hear you sit. And there's some beauty and there's some challenge in that, but it did instill this like, there is a beauty in sitting with elders and observing and being invited into a space of observation as learning, as participation. And at the same time, now that I'm older, I definitely had my butt handed to me by some young students years ago when I first got into teaching, and I was on my high horse about how hip hop, like Nas said, y'all killed it. It's dead. It used to be beautiful. And it was like, wait a minute, Miss, have you heard? And I was like, no. They're like, but why won't you just try listening? And I was like, oh, yeah, you're right. I can listen. I'm trying to help y'all learn how to listen. I can listen. Yeah, you're right. But again, so it's this how I think to check the extremes of both sides, right? Because we might miss that ability to learn. Multi-directionally, like in the cipher, that's what is so beautiful about a cipher. You can be 5, you can be 80. You have to know how to read the energy and understand when to go in, when to stay, understand how to yield, know that you're being held by the whole larger community. And so I think that identifying this relationship between, you know, to Remy's question, passing the torch, like, maybe in that is like maybe inviting us all to think about what is all of our responsibility in taking care of the torch so that we don't like wait till it's like somebody knocks and says it's your turn and you haven't been ready. Or if you're like, man, I can't wait for them to drop it. I'm waiting for you to drop it. And so I'm even thinking about these questions also like no perfect answer today. I might tomorrow wake up and have some more insight, but like what's the opportunity for us to think about how we are in this cipher together, right? So we can nod to our elders and to our present folk and young folk. So we wanna open up for questions from folks. Y'all can raise your virtual blue hands. You can drop it in the chat. You can use the QA function. We got you on Facebook as well. I wanna allow this person to ask this question themselves. Karen Chang, are you still on? We're gonna allow you to talk. Are you still on, Karen?
Yeah.
Ask to unmute. You can unmute yourself if you are.
Hey.
Hey. So Karen typed your question in the chat, but I'm wondering if, or in the Q&A function, it's a juicy one for Brian and Oompa. So I'm wondering if, yeah, raise your eyebrow. You wanna go ahead and ask them juicy questions? I don't wanna touch it.
Oh boy.
Yeah, it's really an utopic question. And I don't know if it's possible to answer, but I just was wondering what your personal thought on this was. My question was if you had the power before to choose if hip hop got commercialized or not, which way would you have chosen? And the second one is another utopic question. If you could choose non-Black people to practice in hip hop culture around the world, would you what would you choose? Yeah.
Right to the lightning rod. Wow.
So I'll say that again. I'll give y'all a second by restating Karen. Karen frames this as utopic. If you could choose hip hop getting commercialized or not, what would you choose? And if you could choose for non-Black people around the world to practice hip hop, would you?
Everything is in the how. It's not in the thing itself, it's always in the how. So the nature of the commercialization, I mean, some people say that, you know, it's capitalist, so it's all bad, just off grip. And I understand that line of thinking. But part of it is the exploitive nature of the people who create the thing. So I would prefer that the relationship between hip hop, in terms of looking at a utopia, I prefer that the relationship between hip hop art forms and the rest of the world not be that of an extractive economy, that it wouldn't be going through neighborhoods and strip mining the talent and then leaving the neighborhood that is rich in talent poor in resources for it, so that the people who make the thing can benefit from it. So that, for me, I think that's the utopic vision. I cannot be mad about folks' participation in it. One, because there are a number of people who have been able to build really great livelihoods for themselves and their families via hip hop, and have managed to help their neighborhoods in some ways. Like I always use the phrase, the knife cuts both ways. You know, so like that nothing is entirely perfect. It does have its blessing, but also has its curse. And you have to kind of accept the good with the bad of it. In terms of the international thing, so the name of my dance crew is Afro Mosaic Soul. The name don't get much blacker than that. That being said, got a cat that's Puerto Rican in the group, got a sister that's Japanese in the group. One of our last members that joined up was from Taiwan. You know, I've been able to meet people from all over the globe because of hip hop. You know, I've been able to have my voice travel all over the world when I couldn't because of global hip hop also. I don't know if I'd want to lose those friendships and what I've learned from having them. I think it's a matter of how the thing goes down. It's not so much that it happened, but it's the nature of how it happens. You know, people can interact, but how they interact is the big thing. So for the utopia, I'd prefer that the way the interactions happen would be more equitable. That would be my utopia, is that the interaction and the connection with hip hop in the larger world would be much more equitable.
I'm 1000% with you. I think we deserve to be superheroes. Like, I think, you know, hip hop artists in their many forms and fashions are heroes and regarded as such. And I think that, you know, with that comes the plight of the superhero, which is you can offer the world so many things. But oftentimes, you know, you go home, like, I don't know, I'm thinking of Spider-Man, playing a Spider-Man game right now. But, you know, you go home and like, he got an eviction notice on his door, you know, but you're making the culture rich, you know, and you're making other people rich. You know, I want us to be able to reap the benefits of being the superheroes like that we collectively have been deemed. And yeah, you said it perfectly. And, as far as other folks' participation, I think, again, you hit the nail on the head. It's about how you do it. I think appreciation versus appropriation is always one place to start. I think that honor and intention are really important. How you honor what you got and where it comes from and what is your intention and your participation are of the like most primary questions for me. That said, you know, if you're completely unrelated and your intention is to be a part of something for some, you know, I don't know, fickle reason, then I think maybe, you know, reapproaching your approach is my preference. So.
I hope that, Karen, thank you so much. Like, clearly Remy and I have been wasting time asking these simple questions. We should have came harder. Thank you, Karen, for those questions. We have one more. Sean is still on. So Sean, we'll invite you to unmic and ask your question yourself if you want to. You want to?
Sure.
Yeah, what up, Sean? Sean's a diehard supporter and also does dope hip hop programming as well. I just want to shout her out. All right, go ahead, Sean.
Sean, you're muted.
Sean? Okay, well.
No, I'm sorry. I was talking. Look, I was over here complimenting everybody. I was saying it was an honor to meet the speakers and I love what y'all are doing, Aysha. I apologize. That won't happen again. But here's the question. The question is, how do you define trap music? Is this new term of trap music? I know. Would you have it fall in the category of hip hop? Very simple question, but it's concerning.
Absolutely. I would definitely call it hip hop, because I think that if I'm leaning into the philosophy that, one, I think in the same way that traps exist, the music that comes therefrom is as legitimate. And I think that there's a culture of being in the trenches or being in a trap. However, I think that part of the problem is that a lot of people making trap music don't have the perspective of being from the trap. And then we go back to his question of honor and intention. But I absolutely think that the music that was coming out of the South, that's in the Midwest, you know, that, and then, you know, kind of just proliferated around the world, you know, to represent communities of people who are in what we call the trap. I think that it's absolutely that's hip hop culture. It's hip hop music. It's part of what it means to be Black and poor, or Black urban, or you know, or rather to have the experience of being Black, poor, and making decisions to stay alive, you know? So I think it's absolutely part of it.
I can't say that it's not. I can't say that it's not a part of hip hop. But also there's a part of me that feels like I'm too old I'm old enough to have an opinion, but I'm too old for my opinion to matter necessarily. I don't know. I can't say that it's my favorite, but then again, like I said, my relationship with hip hop right now, like I consider myself more of a househead than anything, that went through a very long love affair with hip hop and just, you know, like we're not the same anymore, but still, I mean, the thing is that it's still becoming a part of you know, it's so closely regarded in hip hop circles. The only time that people seem to have a problem with it is when it's a purist thing. When somebody's like, you know, on a whole, like, oh, this is real hip hop and anything that's not this is not real hip hop. And you gotta format this way. And the beat has to be made this way. And it's gotta have this such and such. And if you don't use an SP-12000, then it ain't real hip hop. You know, like, so I don't know. I think, like, for me, it's just like, you know what? I'm old. Like, what we think about that, it's hot and cold, whether or not that really even matters. If this is what folks are doing and what folks are rhyming over, then it's what people are rhyming over. It's the new sound, you know? At first, people were rhyming over other folks' breaks. Then somebody got some cheap drum machines, and then it was the cheap drum machines, and those cheap drum machines didn't sound like a James Brown break. You know, there was a whole other sound behind it. Then it went back to sampling, you know, the breaks. Then it went to, you know, the whole Neptune, like you talk about cycles, Oompa, and like, you know, so this whole thing of like being sample based and then being entirely electronic based, and how that cycle kind of keeps going in hip hop. But one moment everybody's sampling everything, and the next moment everything's mad electronic, nobody's using samples, and it sounds, you know, like it's from 200 years in the future. And then it flips again, and then everybody's using samples and referencing old stuff again. And so.
And also, you know, like a lot of people, you know, they try to, you know, like a lot of the people I grew up with would try to say that hip hop started as, you know, a social, like a tool for, you know, social reform of some sort. But like it started in the parties, you know, like it was party music. And you know, then we have the so-called gangster rap that happened, you know, in the 90s, but then that resurfaced again in the 2000s. And, you know, then we had the dance era where it was like bubblegum and it was all fun and everybody was cranking that Soulja Boy and you know, you know what I'm saying? And then we got some of that now. And, you know, and so I think, and then the Southern music took over in the 2000s as well. And then now we see what's happening with trap music and even drill music, which is like the new offspring of trap music in some way, you know? So just cycles. It's all a part of it, it seems.
I don't Yeah, I don't think, and also I don't know if they're, I think one of the things too is that we're, things don't stay underground or like incubated long enough to kind of create their own fully separate identity anymore. So like with say like house or techno, like those styles were, you know, underground in Detroit and Chicago and in New York for a minute before the rest of Black America heard them, let alone the rest of America or the rest of the world, you know? Right. So it's like they had time to kind of develop its own identity separate from other music styles and then come to the fore, as opposed to this is this new genre and within a month of it coming out, folks all around the world already listening to it and making music in response to it. So then like, it's not a secret. It doesn't develop on its own. It's like, as soon as it's born, it's out on the boulevard with everybody looking at it.
Straight up.
And I think that also changes the dynamic of, you know, where before you could easily say like, oh, this is this genre. Oh, this is this subgenre now. Oh, this is this. It's like they had enough time to develop its own identity to be looked at as easily seen as something separate. Mm-hmm. Now it's kind of fuzzy because, you know, when people ask like how far back drill goes, and it's like, okay, but people were already making stuff in response to it. Like, you know, like it just got here, but there were already people trying to make splinter versions of drill. Mm-hmm. You know, the Houston sound with like, you know, like that whole sound has been around for a long time. And people have been doing variations of chopped and screwed for a long time. Mm-hmm. You know, so I don't, you know, and at no point, I don't know. And the thing is, people will still rhyme over stuff like that. So I don't know I can't say that it's not hip hop, but then the thing with hip hop too is hip hop is like jazz or like classical. You can kind of make anything work with hip hop. Like folks find ways to rhyme over anything. You know, same way you can turn anything into a classical score, you know, same way you could turn anything into a bebop record. I mean, I've heard it. It's kind of wild times.
I need a house playlist from you too, if you don't mind.
I know, I'm like, Brian, can you?
We'll talk afterwards, but.
Send a link. Listen, y'all have blessed us with so much. So for folks who are still on, we may go over just a couple minutes. We hope that you can rock with us to the end because we do have a tradition. I got more questions I just want to rap with y'all about. I'm like, what y'all think people gonna be rapping and dancing to in 10 years? Like when they put a chip in our ear and that's our streaming device. Anyway, but I just am so appreciative of the nuggets of the insight of the perspective that you all brought. Like to me, this is education. This space that we had just right now was a dope, real classroom, no pretense, just keeping it real and getting into the funky nooks and crannies and crevices of this whole conversation. So we do have a tradition where we wrap up at the end. So definitely you can stay on. We want you to stay on. We won't close this until all bars, Top Rocks, or skates, if you just need to find us a little happy medium house hip hop beat. I don't even know what that is, but you know, Rim Cycle will figure it out. But we're gonna invite our guests to wrap up and seal the time with a bar. Again, a bar could be rhymes, could be movement, can be free verse, whatever. And if we have anybody that's feeling very motivated to join in. I know that there is an artist on here, Ella, I don't wanna call you out, but I just did. You're welcome. It's exciting. So just saying, we have this time because, you know, also the thing about hip hop is the cipher. And I know that I personally miss gathering with folks, leaning in and observing and feeling fed by the energy. So we try to bring that into our closing ritual. So Remy, do you think you got a beat for us today?
I do.
Oh, snap, y'all, get ready. Don't forget to do the, yeah, your share sound is on. So, oh, Ella, did you want to jump in on this? You got any other folks? Okay.
Y'all ready? What's that?
No, I'm not.
Like I said, I could go first if y'all feeling nervous. I'm MC such and such.
touch my father. So fast, love, and catch my father. So fast, love, and catch my father.
Nothing rhymes with that. But I'm gonna keep going, cause I'm a cool cat. Sometimes I'm Ellie's block, cause I represent the block. But I'm willing to tap it off. Who's next? Who wants to keep it going? So you sign off.
I'll go. Yep. All right, it might be a delay. Yo. Yo, it's what I've been through. My mama jeans stronger than a mental. Now I ain't saying I'm exempt from depression and contempt. I'm just saying all the you know I've been through. It should have pulled me out the game a long time ago. And coach told me fourth quarter where you find the goal. Yeah, and everybody got it, but not everybody got it, man. You better off if you find a team to run the rock with. It's real easy to catch a head case, especially in this world that look like black like it's dead space. And they always trying to spit that shit with violence. It's all about perspective. Can't we say the same about silence? Always trying to fill it with our little bitty selves, like we bigger than this world, like we ain't a bunch of cells just here to fit the mold, man. I'm done with metaphors. What I mean to say, it's always gonna end up better for you. Trust the process.
Niceness. In a very reflective moment, sometimes I can see it, sometimes I can own it, I can hold it. Feel like I've lived many lives within this one, and somehow I receive to keep my vision focused. Sometimes I feel like I'm the brokest or the richest, depending on what side of the vision is on. 20 and 20 in both eyes, stigmatized, still I realize, got to rise, like Maya Angelou, still I. People like constantly moving through, will I or won't I, is the question of the day. Somehow the rhyme stayed in. Who knew the old rust could scrape off and be polite to still come through with the rhyme that make you take off. Rocket ships, intergalactic magic. I don't know, some lyrical, miracle, spiritual stuff that ended, and that's it.
Yo, we're
going
to
wow.
Yeah, freestyled in like a decade, boy.
It was the 2020 and both eyes stigmatized. You didn't have to do that to us like that.
Was that an exclusive returning to the freestyle?
Yeah, man, wow. But man, Oompa, like solid.
Oh, thank you. And full disclosure, in hip hop fashion, it was not a freestyle.
Okay, I was about to say, because I was like, that was like airtight. I was like, ooh.
Yeah, no, my freestyle? No.
I have freestyle.
Me and my sister would call that a perfect style.
Oh, like, perfect. Like, oh, because you.
Like perfect style. Like when your freestyle sounds like it's a written.
Yeah.
Like, so like everything is, like it lines up on the beat, the then metaphor, the line up the whole story. I was like, oh, it's perfect style. It's like, ooh.
I love that. It's like perfect pitch, but I like love that.
We love y'all. Virtual and real. I'm everybody's hype person. Hugs, high tens, roof raises, because I'm also older. but thank you all so much. Also, Scott Wiley said, you ain't old yet. So.
Yes, Scott Wiley's only saying that because of I'm old, he's old. That's why.
Ooh, okay. You want to be starting something? I don't want to be starting nothing between nobody, you know. Well, I'll say we have, I'll quickly let Remy have the final wrap up, but I just want to say again, thank you both for blessing the space, for being here, for getting on the wrap up mic, but really just enlightening the conversation around these so-called schools and for reminding us to like be alive in the moment and remember to connect to people. Like, and we can worry about how this works itself off out 40 years from now about where we are, but be where we are right now. So thank y'all. really quickly, Brian or Oompa, do y'all have any upcoming events? How can people, oh, Brian is older than me is what Scott wants to, Scott it might be being 50 Cent petty right now. He might be 50 Cent game a little strong right now though. But I wanna, you know, we gotta make sure we promote and self-promote. I also never seize a moment to say that for any folks who are looking for a way to make Black Lives Matter more than a hashtag, please support these Black artists directly. Mm-hmm. With visual, fiscal, emotional, spiritual support, but real support. So with that, if there's anything that you all want to promote to let people know where to find you, please let us know.
Well, first, thank you and thank Remy and thank you, Brian. It was a pleasure to meet and see y'all and be a part of this. My brain got to stretch out today because I just been building this little IKEA thing. So I really got to get my brain stretched on it. I'm really grateful for that and to be talking about something I love with Brilliant Mind. So thank you again for having me. The best thing to do is to listen to my music and to tell people that you like me, that you like me. And then hopefully they'll tell two more people and it grows like that. Starting October, I think 28th it is, you can pre-buy tickets now, but I think it's available October 28th. I have a show. We just did a live recording show with the Oberon. And so it's like a full stage, full production show. And that'll be available starting the 28th. It's pay what you can. And you have it available to stream for 48 hours. It's gonna be a good time. So please follow me and support that show. And I have new music coming out. So just stay in touch with me. I thank you for listening.
Thank you for being, wow. There's still a part of me that's absolutely beside myself just being in this moment, because all of this is just really awesome and just really makes my heart swell with just joy and happiness. In terms of Facebook, Afro Mosaic Soul on Facebook, that's the dance crew. We're celebrating our 15th anniversary coming towards the end of this month. And I just found some old DV tapes of some of our first shows from 15 years ago. So that will be getting digitized and put up. That's Scott Wiley in the chat. Wyland's one of the members of the crew. And then on the scholar side of it, Kut The Rug Institute is on Instagram. Kut with the K, K-U-T underscore the underscore rug. And we're on Instagram, and that's a think tank around street dance. And we are in the planning mode right now. So we're reading books and having bi-weekly meetings and basically trying to figure out what we can do to collaborate with other dancers in order to push the conversation about street dance forward and enlighten each other and enlighten the rest of the world. So we're building on that as well. Anything else, Brian Polite is my real name and the internet works. I'm actually frighteningly easy to find if you're so inclined. Most of my pics are kind of all the same four pics on everything. So like I'm easy to identify everywhere.
Is it the profile joint? Is it that picture where you turned on the profile?
I try not to be too mysterious. So when people see my face, they'd be like, oh, it's that guy again. The profile one is the new one. I'm gonna swap something out for that soon.
I like it. Thank you both. Well, again,
thank you.
Yes, I wanna appreciate you both so much. I think what I'm taking away is that Oompa, you said the word love, like just the absolute love that you both have for your craft and for this culture. And I'm so appreciative of that. Tomorrow, for folks who are watching, we have guest DJ Elm Street, who Brian knows. He's going to be on Instagram Live with us at HipHopEX Lab. We're going to be taking requests. It's a community playlist, and the topic is "What's a Hip Hop Throwback to You?" So come through same time tomorrow, 5 to 6:15 p.m. Eastern. That's on our Instagram. And then Friday, we're going to be talking about translating hip hop from the streets to the stage. And when does that work? And we have Q, right?
Coming yes.
Keelan Q. Arnold. And that'll be a little bit more of a community conversation as well. So hope to see y'all for the rest of the week. We're gonna keep talking about schools of hip hop. And thanks everyone for being here.
Thank you.
Hit me with the horn, 20. Keep making noise. Keep making noise.
Peace, y'all.
Hey.